knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
By 12,000 years ago, the world was completely covered with hunter-gatherers. By this time, we know from geology that the last glacial maximum was coming to an end, and giant ice sheets were receding to the poles. Likely from a mixture of this climatic change and competition from Homo sapiens, all other hominins and a majority of megafauna went extinct around the world. We discussed ice ages in the ecology series, so be sure to check that out if you need more information about this process. But for our purposes here, these changes ushered in a new epoch, the Holocene. As the climate warmed, some areas with only seasonal productivity became productive year-round, supplemented by fertile land in river valleys. Predictably, people began to congregate in these areas, and populations grew. This brings us to southwestern Turkey, where a site represents this magnificently, Göbekli Tepe. The discovery of Göbekli Tepe truly got the ball rolling on the paradigm shift discussed in the previous tutorial. Because of its important link between the complexity of hunter-gatherers and the rise of civilization, Göbekli Tepe has become famous, especially among lost Ice Age civilization theorists on the internet. However, we know a lot about the site and where it fits in with the birth of civilization, but there is still a lot to discover, as only a small part of the site has been excavated. New data is being teased out of the site every year. Officially discovered in the 1960s, the site was presumed to be medieval in origin until excavations by Dr. Klaus Schmidt in the 1990s. Dr. Schmidt realized the site was very special. The site contains large structures called enclosures built with stone. Inside these enclosures are megalithic monuments covered in intricate carvings. Some of these pillars are 5.5 meters tall. There is also evidence of a large permanent population at the site. Keep in mind that what you see here is approximately 5% of the site. Yet, the beginning of the site's construction dates to 11,500 years ago, before the advent of agriculture. Confirming this, many studies of the food remains found in residential areas point toward versions of plants that were still undomesticated. This is what has caused the dramatic reimagining of hunter-gatherer peoples of the Pleistocene. In the old model, permanent, complex populations didn't exist until agriculture created food surpluses. Then people could be freed from solely gathering food and focus on things like stoneworking, which could let people create monuments on the scale of something like Göbekli Tepe. While this is likely still true in many regards, as we couldn't have seen cities like Rome or Babylon without agriculture, there is a much higher degree of complexity that hunter-gatherers can exhibit than first presumed. Attributes like monumental architecture or permanent population centers aren't unique to agricultural groups. Göbekli Tepe also exemplifies the important role of religion in the first large gathering of people in fertile places. The site seems to have a ritual purpose and is interpreted as a temple complex. The current interpretation is that many hunter-gatherer groups used the temples to conduct religious activities and to throw celebrations at certain times of the year. However, there isn't a highly productive marine ecosystem in the area for these people to take advantage of. They relied on the productivity of river valleys to support their populations. People were likely aware that planting seeds grew into the plant the seed came from for millennia. However, people relying on fertile river valleys began utilizing this to a degree not before seen. Because of the favorable environmental conditions the ending of the last glacial maximum provided, and the extinction of megafauna, they became more and more reliant on this substance strategy. While it is best documented in the Middle East, this happened all around the world at different times, with a variety of different plants. As more and more people began to live settled or semi-settled lives, some began keeping the animals they hunted in enclosures and bred them. Animals and plants utilized in this way changed as humans artificially selected them for desirable traits, becoming domesticated. Domesticated plants are called crops, and domesticated animals are called livestock. While this technique was used throughout the world, five river valleys in particular produced a special kind of crop, grain. Grains were domesticated from grasses and can be grown close together and in high quantities. With these crops, humans can practice a subsistence technique called intensive agriculture. With this, the vast majority, if not all, of the food consumed by a population comes from domesticated organisms. The five river valleys this arose in are called the cradles of civilization. These cradles of civilization were an area of the Middle East and Africa called the Fertile Crescent, the Indus Valley of India and Pakistan, the Yellow River Valley of China, the lowlands of Mexico, and the river valleys of the Western Andes of Peru. These agricultural practices then spread across continents. In the Old World, this new agricultural way of life is called the Neolithic period. It was these river valleys that led to the birth of the first civilizations. But what is a civilization? The definition of this word is constantly debated in anthropology. Societies are so different that grouping them based on shared overall traits leads to problems. However, there are some generally agreed upon characteristics that early civilizations had which we can use to distinguish them from other societies. 1. A civilization has cities, which are settlements of thousands of people living in close proximity to each other. 2. There is a certain degree of social stratification present, meaning there are leaders and people under them, also known as a bureaucracy. 3. Trade specialization is present, so you have people who are exclusively carpenters, stonemasons, cooks, and so forth. And 4. There is a form of record keeping to maintain the bureaucracy. This was usually in the form of writing, but other methods existed, such as the record-keeping quipus of the Inca. Keep in mind that the characteristics listed above refer to the degree of the characteristic present rather than a simple yes or no. Therefore, it can be fairly subjective when determining if a culture is or isn't a civilization. As of now, the first widely accepted civilization to arise was those of the Fertile Crescent of Mesopotamia, or the land between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. Let's talk about that next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.